Oh, glass, you beautiful amorphous translucent mystery, tell me your secrets. Hello everyone, Julian back again for DNews. Physicists from the University of Waterloo, McMaster University, ESPCI Paris Tech, and Université Paris de Troyes all joined forces to answer a long-standing question about glass. And that question was, how does glass form? Yes, even though we've been making it for over 3,500 years, we still weren't sure how or why it formed until physicists from four separate institutions solved the puzzle just last month. Apparently, the answer was a lot simpler than anyone had expected, combining two older models for how glass molecules behaved. One is molecular crowding, that states that molecules on the surface of the glass can keep moving, while the more crowded molecules on the interior can't unless the molecules around it cooperate. This cooperative movement is the second puzzle piece, and it's both helped and hindered by the weak bonds between glass molecules. Taken together, these ideas explain how glass behaves at a molecular level. And believe it or not, it's more tricky than you think. Glass isn't technically a solid, and you may have been told it's a liquid, but that's not true either. It's an amorphous solid, meaning it lacks the crystalline or polycrystalline repeated structures of other solids. This lack of a pattern and the weak chemical bonds explains how glass can behave like a brittle solid, and also accounts for the glass-liquid transition, which is when heated glass is between a supercooled liquid state and a solid state, and it behaves like a rubbery, viscous liquid. The molecules on the surface of glass never actually stop moving, though, even when cooled. They do move extremely slowly, but they move nonetheless. A common myth about glass is because of this movement, antique glass is sagged over the years, and that's why many old buildings and church windows have glass that's thicker on the bottom. That's likely just an imperfection in how the glass was made, because for a flat plane of glass to sag at room temperature, it would take longer than the age of the universe. And I don't think churches have been around that long. Plus, even older glass from Egypt doesn't have that sagged quality to it, so there goes that myth. The lack of a crystalline structure is often used to explain why glass is transparent, and I'd like to debunk that while we're at it. You may have heard that light passes through glass because there's space between the disorganized molecules and photons can get through. It's not the space between the molecules, but the way the molecules react with photons, which is to say, they don't. Photons in visible light don't have enough energy to excite the electrons in glass, so instead they pass through it unchanged. Ultraviolet light, however, does have enough energy to excite the electrons, so when UV light hits oxide glass, like in your car's window, the photon is absorbed and the UV light is stopped. It's why you don't get sunburned sitting inside your car with the windows rolled up. And if you were some hypothetical creature that could only see ultraviolet light, you wouldn't be able to see through a window. This glass stuff, man, it's cooler than you think. Case in point, we're trying to search for life on Mars in glass. Dr. Ian O'Neill explains here.
Glass can form when minerals in rock are exposed to sudden heating. So the extreme impact pressures and searing heat generated during a meteorite impact can produce certain types of glasses.
Have you heard the glass is a liquid myth before? It's pretty common and it drives me mad. If there are other myths or legends you want us to science, let us know in the comments or on Facebook or Twitter. Subscribe so you can see when we answer it. And I'll see you next time on DNews.